Here. So again, let's give him a round of applause. Welcome back, Mr. Mark.
What a wonderful night last night. One thing for sure is you guys need a bigger boat. We gotta sell some stuff. That was a lot of fun. Boy, this sounds loud.
I'll turn it down a little bit.
Yeah. Okay. Feel like I should have a guitar.
Let's push a button.
Testing 1, 2. Testing a little better. Yeah. So as Dan said, I think what we'd like to go through today is talk a little bit first at an organizational level and how you can start to build some of the structure when you get back. It is very ambitious to think that we're going to be able to do this in a 45 or 60 minute session today, but I'd like to kind of go through the building blocks. It'll help you, hopefully, like we said yesterday, if you can block out an hour or two when you get back and say, I'm going to make a commitment to go through this stuff, and I'm going to make a commitment to put together these 2 or 3 key pieces. I think you will really find different results over the next few months. And again, we'll talk about this and how it all will work. So this first session, if you have the book in front of you, Business Growth Architecture Workshop, let's flip to this first page. And there are some blank spots in there, and I'll give you the words as we kind of go through it. To review what I said yesterday, selling success is due to far more than technique, right? So again, I think many times in business we focus way too much on the sales side, we're focusing way too much on the technique side. So today we're going to start to build this architecture, which is going to be your process. This process, again, proactively and rhythmically communicates your value propositions to the market. We'll go through that a little bit. Today, again, we're gonna try to dig in a little bit. You'll be working with strategic targets as you grow in your business and hopefully building trusting relationships that enable us to learn about buying systems and how these buying systems buy and what their motivation to buy is. So everything that we're gonna do over the next hour and a half, 2 hours or so is really built on this foundation. So let's dig in. Let's dig in, flip the page. As you remember yesterday, I think if you don't have the resources to hire dedicated people, you need to find a way to dedicate yourself. So I think on the supply side, you've got to match that on the demand side. You've got to find the time. If I said to you, I could just as easily be sitting here talking about your accounting system, but you couldn't imagine not doing reconciling your accounts every month, paying your bills, loading your bills, sending invoices, collecting money. You have processes in place for all of that. You wouldn't think, let's go 3 months before we need to do this, before I send out invoices, or before we pay bills. But somehow on the sales side, we don't see that system as an important system, probably because it's a little bit less tangible. But you have to have the same sort of attention to detail, you have to have the same sort of attention to the process as you would for accounting or any other process in your system. So dedicated people, defined processes, and a performance management system. Again, just like you would in your accounting systems. Down below, this is just a depiction, if you will. Most of us are really focused on those white boxes, the propose, perform, and cultivate new work. Those green boxes are the ones that this system that you're going to design today and over the coming weeks, these green boxes are what we're really talking about, though. What is the strategy in the market? Can you identify targets, researching them? How do you design messaging systems, prospect, and then position? So, as we said yesterday, top performers who work in a bad process produce below average results. On the other hand, average performers who work in a quality process produce above average results.
In a what process?
In a above average process. So quality process produce above average results. So on this next page, I would like you to take a minute on business architecture. As I said yesterday, there's 4 questions that I ask organizations when I work with them to try to begin to understand who they are and what they do. And the 4 questions are, what do you supply? That sounds like a really, really easy question. It's not. We'll talk about it. What do you supply? How do you supply it? who buys it, and why they buy it from you. The answer to those four questions will help you really get good at what you do. So, raise your hand if you want to help. Yeah, go ahead.
Can I ask a question? So the question says, what do you sell? Which to me is different than what do I supply?
Okay. So what do you sell? And then what do you supply? What's the difference?
Well, what I sell is a peace of mind regarding their point of sale system. What I supply is computers and software and services.
Sure. I think both answers are important. You know, I think both answers. I understand what you're saying. You're talking from a psychological perspective, purposeful, which I think is really useful. But when somebody fills out a PO, in this particular case, I'm really interested in what is it that you sell. So are you selling sub-assemblies? Do you package things? Are you selling software? Are you selling a certain service? Whatever it might be, I think it's important for each organization to understand what is the portfolio that they're putting into the market. So the value propositions, when we talk about why people buy it from you, that's more of the hard stuff that I think you're thinking about, which I agree with. So describe, somebody raise their hand and describe their business and what is it that they supply? What do you supply? When somebody issues a PO, what do?
I supply a point of sale software terminal equipment, that sort of thing.
Okay. So when people buy from you, they're getting the equipment, they're getting the software, they make credit card transactions.
They get credit card processing, gift card transactions, you know, a whole package of, you know, might be, you know, mobile marketing ideas, things like that. But my target is independently owned hospitality restaurants, 1-3 terminal. Target market is restaurants that currently don't operate off a point of sale. They operate off a traditional cash register and credit card terminal. Those are the target, that's the only prospect.
Okay, so go back to product and service. So hardware, software for credit card transaction. Do any of you sell services beyond that?
Yeah. I do ongoing service support, you know, other add-on type stuff like online ordering. They might need that, you know.
Do any of you sell something other than what Dan just described? Yeah.
All right, so where Dan's focused on the POS market as Hunter, we service the B2B marketplace and we use a gateway to service that to give them a more efficient way of processing. So we really focus on three aspects, which is one is how do we secure your data? Number two is how do we improve your efficiency? And number three is, after that is done, we talk about how we can save you some money.
Yep, good. Any other comments on that? I think it's really important, and in these boxes below, I would like you can do it now if you like, you can certainly do it when you get home, but begin to describe that product and service that you offer, and then Dan, like you were saying, I like to take people through, you know, what of each of these, what's the percentage of revenue? Is the margin for that particular product or service high, average, low? Are you spending, what I'm trying to get at is, are you spending the right time growing the right pieces of your business and moving it? Something you'll do for a low margin because it's strategically important to have it in your portfolio, and I understand that. But is that what you're leading with? Probably not. So be thinking about, okay, these are the three things I get purchase orders for, or I get requests for. What strategically do I need to extend my offer to make me more viable? What do each of these represent as far as my revenue stream, my total revenue stream, and my margin? Know where you're making your money. Jim Collins talks about the economic engine. Understand your economic engine and how you make money. And then how you can have a residual. It sounds like you guys do that. So you have sort of residual income that's coming monthly. Many of you are servicing and you're getting that money on a regular basis. So take some time to understand specifically what it is that you sell. How do you supply it? So what I'm talking about here is understanding I like to understand what are the three or four stages to a deal. Yes, go ahead.
Sorry. I'm not sure if I caught that right. As far as your lead-in is not the low margin.
I'm sorry?
Your lead-in is not your low margin. Sometimes it is a low margin lead-in to get, like, it's a door opener. So
Yeah, I try not to, but I understand sometimes in your business you might have to do that, but I usually try not to. I'm trying, usually when I'm going to sell, I liked, you know, the description a little bit where you're coming in with a solution. You know, you're coming in, this is what we're gonna do for you. And, you know, I know you guys often, first thing they're gonna ask you is gonna, you know, what's your price? You know, so what's the charge that I'm gonna get? And it's gonna be lower than I'm getting today. And you say, we'll cover that. You know, that's something we'll cover. We're gonna be competitive, but.
We tend to go more though with what product or solution works best in that situation, as opposed to where our larger profit margin, although we try to tie those two together. So we're offering the right product or service to the right marketplace. That ties back to what you're saying about knowing what you're selling, so you know where to market it.
Yeah, I know the market, you know, understand the market. Some markets maybe you need to go in price.
Sometimes in ours though, in our unique setting, you know, we go in with a low margin for something, but then we're getting a higher margin on residuals in the back end. So yeah.
So you use a low margin as a hook. You know.
Essentially knowing that the food is ongoing there versus a high margin here with nothing after. So
right.
Sometimes it's a...
Right. Yeah.
Like I built my credit card processing based on leading with gift and loyalty back when paper gift certificates. So I led with another product, but I'd end up getting their credit card processing at the end,
right,
which was my margin.
Yeah, yeah, okay. So it was kind of coattail, you kind of brought it in.
Most of the merchants have absolutely no idea what the pricing is and how it's priced. And they look at the initial offer and don't understand anything about credit card processing. And when you start explaining it to them about mid-qualified, non-qualified, and all that other stuff, it's kind of consuming to them because they don't know it and they think they're being misled by the previous people that have been serviced.
Right.
Now, I would totally disagree with that. In my marketplace, even the merchant understands interchange these days. They've been called on. They're so much more educated today on credit card processing. No, you know, in my sector, there's tiered pricing isn't even an option. It's all interchange plus. So I think the merchants are much more educated on pricing today than ever before. But it depends on the market.
Depends on market segment where you're going. So how do you supply what it is you supply? So how do you guys get your initial leads, or how do people call you, or do you have bankers that you partner with, or what? How do you get your leads?
I'd say if you interviewed every person in this room, they might have a different answer.
Yeah.
Traditionally, there's a couple different models. Referral sources.
Okay.
Like you just said, whether they be association, banks, sending us leads.
Yeah.
There's the traditional model of hitting the streets, prospecting, picking up the phone, picking a market SIC code, doing your traditional mailers, follow up, whatever.
Okay.
And then there's the gathering side where they're e-marketing, doing a lot of internet partnering with me. You know, so I'd say we get 50 different answers in here.
Well, good.
And as you build your business here, you can grow your existing base too.
Right. So what I would propose that you do, at least at a minimum, try to understand the three or four major stages of the how you supply what it is that you do. And I want to understand, like, how you get people's attention and how they come into your funnel. If you propose, how you propose, look at your proposals and how those work. You could do a whole session just on proposing work. And then how do you engage? How do people become customers? How do you collect money? Kind of go through those stages. And the reason, the end game for all of that is because I'd like you to begin to understand where various prospects are in those stages. And I think you begin to understand the business growth model a little bit more when you can understand each stage, start to break it down a little bit. There are some industries, I don't know if yours is one, I don't think it is. There are those industries where you go from a prospect knowing you to engaging with you in an hour and a half. That's pretty rare, but it does happen, you know, in the one call close type places. My guess is that's not happening with you guys. You're probably doing demonstrations, you're probably showing them examples, and you're proposing certain pieces of work or packages. I think it's really useful to understand those stages, again, so that you can identify later when we start talking about our tip report, you can identify your prospects, where they're at, better forecasting and timing, which I think is also very useful. So describe the stages of the sale. Let's flip the page. Who buys what you sell? So this was a conversation that we that you know Dan has started. Some of you probably use SIC code research, but if you remember yesterday, the funnel that I had, there's food stamp establishments, there's fast casual, there's fast casual that's privately held, there's fast casual that's less than 20 employees. Who is your ideal buyer, client? So first organization-wise, and then what's the title or person inside that organization? Is it the owner? Is it the IT person? Is it the CFO? And I'm sure it depends on the organization. So get a good description though, and you'll see my little example here. This is healthcare. And 100 mile radius, more than 100 beds, you know, these sort of things. Get specific about the type of ideal customer profile for your business. That doesn't mean you're not going to do business with people outside of that. It just means that if you had, you could be the best. You can compete with the best or be the best in that particular market. You have a story to tell, and you can tell it over and over and over again. This is what we specialize in. We work with people like you all day long. You know, this is what we do. And describe that. So, what do you sell? How do you supply it? Who buys it? And then, again, why do they buy it from you? I would like you to take 1 minute, because I don't know if you did yesterday or not, and I'd like you to think about, right now, why do you think people are buying from you? Use that chart if it's helpful to you. So what's a feature of your organization? What's the benefit to the customer? From the customer's perspective, what's the benefit? And then lastly, what's a tangible difference? Can you prove it? Take a minute, write down a couple of things. This will help you. And everybody's different. Yourself to get past the, it's important, I don't want to downplay it, but this, you know, service with a smile stuff. Try to get past that. Okay, anybody want to share maybe one that they had that they wrote down?
Trust.
How do you prove it? So that's a value proposition. You can trust those.
What examples of merchants that you're dealing with right now?
Have them say that.
Yeah.
Good. That's good.
In the I mean, cause we all have so many different niches that we go after, but on the processing side, you know, I basically say, you know, the value is you're getting me, right? And there's hundreds of people that do what I do,
yeah.
But there aren't too many people that do it like we do.
Right.
Okay. And I said, you know, between a local attainable office, and we have all these references that can back it up, and a very high retention, you know, and we do the processing for these chambers. So you're automatically getting some stuff. This is why we are different. Mm-hmm. Honest information, attainability, the things that the old person that you haven't seen in months or years, mm-hmm. you know, or you have no idea how you're set up. So just the honest information and the access to resources in a local office that actually knows who you are. More of a value-added statement, but it's, you know, and have the local people that will back it up, you'd be more than happy to talk about it.
Yes. So even further, you know, we're in this region, we have this many offices, we service this 50-mile radius, I'm in it every day. we have over X applications in this 50-mile radius. So I like the idea of a customer saying those things, but when you say they get you, that's good. And I'm in the field every day, and I work this area, and I've lived in this area, my kids are in this area, this is our home. This
yeah,
is
we show what them. We do. So I go through and show them my iPad and my phone, say, look at me, these people have texted me with a question, and we quickly get back to them, or we come over here, we're attainable. Right. And they're blown away by that, but.
Right, that's good. Others?
Yeah, we do credit card processing, our primary business is point of sale. Mm-hmm. And I think about a restaurant that's busy Friday night and it's just going to go down, which it does. A lot of the competitors try to do direct sales online. We have local support, that's our main feature. And when your restaurant's crowded and you've got thousands of dollars tied up and customers that are really going to get upset and never come back, we have trucks on the street per person on 24 hours a day, which is a costly thing to be able to provide. Trucks are fully stocked, and they park it on the system in the restaurant, and we can have you up at times, but it'll probably take till one day.
Right. That's good. That's good. We have four trucks. We have staff that our average tenure is 6 years. We respond typically within 60 minutes of a call or whatever it is. You know, those are the kind of things that are real strong value propositions. And then prove it.
But you can't afford to do that doing it online like the other
ones. Right.
They're more expensive.
Right. It's a lot more touch. A lot more touch. So, again, if you haven't outlined it really well today, when you get back, outline that stuff out. It's important. You got it in your head. Make sure if you do have staff, make sure all your people are saying the same things too. You know, make sure that they get the same message to the market that you are. Make sure everybody who's in one of those trucks understands the value of it, what they're doing. And when I ran that distributor in the 80s, I was kind of anal about it. I mean, we time-stamped things. It was a distributor where people would come to a counter and they would buy stuff. So the one place that I ran was a big mechanical contractor place. So the mechanical contractors would come in and they'd buy HVAC equipment and they'd install rooftop air conditioning and heaters and all that stuff. Well, they would come with their truck and they would pick up units and supplies and all that. So when they walked through the door, I used to timestamp people and how long they were there and how long they got out. And then I started advertising that you could get in and out of our business in 12 minutes with your stuff. 98% fill rate. Had free coffee in the lobby with donuts, you know, that kind of stuff. So measure it, talk about it, and because I do think some of you, especially if you're going local, like it sounds like a lot of you are, you really need to beat up that big national, the one that's, you know, not paying attention to its customer, it's online. And sure, they're great and they're big and all that neat stuff, but to us, you're special. You're important. We live here. Our people work here. I think you got to push those value props. You got to push that touch and prove it again. You have to prove it as much as you can. Any questions on that? Any others want to contribute on that? It's good. So let's talk a little bit about, as I talked about yesterday, opportunity filters. These are tools for you guys that would probably be pretty intuitive and quick, but opportunity filter generally will help us understand the quality of an opportunity. That blank spot, the quality of an opportunity. So at COAC, every opportunity that we get for a client, we have the system, and there's 3 to 4 variables that we use for each client, and we grade each opportunity based on the quality of the opportunity. Again, for some of you, if you're 1 or 2 person shops, you know it off the top of your head. But if you are running a little bit bigger system, you have a little bit more opportunities than most, you'll want to understand the quality of those opportunities in your sales funnel. So this tool helps you understand the investment or risk associated with pursuing a particular opportunity. After a while, you get pretty good at understanding whether this is, I'm going to use a number, 17 or 6, and it's going to be based on how you grade it. When you flip to the next page, you'll see. But it should help your sales team estimate the likelihood of winning an opportunity. And I think these are very instrumental in helping you determine a sales forecast. So determine a sales forecast. I don't know about you, but when I look at my sales funnel report, what we call the tip report, and I see it with a bunch of quality stuff in it, and I see it with a bunch of stuff that's coming up over the next 30, 60 days, I act different. I'm a different person. I'm a different owner when that's happening. And when it's not happening, I don't see a lot of quality stuff in it. Boy, I'll tell you, my focus really, you know, it gets hard and fast. So I think you need to have some of these tools. You know, in my organization, we put all this stuff on the wall. We look at it every week. And we go through, we look at the quality of the leads that we have, when they're going to close, how many we have, and we go through them every Monday morning. Again, if you're a small shop, this probably should be in your day timer, the back page of your book, and you should know who your opportunities are. You should know who you proposed work to. You should know who's going to close when and for how much. Flip the page. So when you get back and you want to start to design your opportunity filter, this chart helps me usually. The far left, look at the best opportunities or wins that you had over a recent time, last 6 months or a year. On the far right, you know what it is. Identify those that were not that big. They weren't the best opportunities. Maybe you lost them, or you got them and didn't like them once you got them. And then move in on both of those and describe the characteristics or traits of the best and those that weren't the best. And then in the middle, start to identify what the ideal opportunity looks like. That could be your market, it could be a style of a prospect, but begin to identify best you can what those characteristics or traits are of a good opportunity. Once you have that column filled out, that green one in the middle, that begins to be, if you go to the page next to it on the right, that begins to be those items, annual revenue potential. So maybe your best opportunities are those people that have repeat capability, like they have more than 10 units and 10 locations. So they have the ability to buy at each location. Maybe that's one item. Or they have more than X terminals, or they have more than X transactions, whatever it might be. Those characteristics or traits then become part of these items in your opportunity filter. In this particular example, it's annual revenue. Is the client motivated? Motivated means, is there something broke, or are they growing? What is their motivation? Very high, or average, or low? You know, like, I feel like I'm pushing it. Then come up with best you can after you have those items. You fill out this chart, ideal opportunity, you've got some characteristics or traits, fill in the items, and then best you can, 1, 3, 5, objectively write out what a description of a 5 looks like in that area. What does a 5 look like for a motivated client? What does a 5 look like with the number of competitors that I'm dealing with? What does a 1 look like? And then over time, again, it sounds like it's a little detail, but over time, you'll get really good at this, and you'll begin to understand when you go up on that wall. Like I said earlier, I've got a 17 here, this is good, and I gotta get these guys. And there's a 4, where are we gonna spend our time? Because you all have a pie chart of time, right? We already talked that it's really hard to do this work. So in that 2 hours a week, that 4 hours a week that you're gonna sit down and dedicate yourself to this, spend it on the 17s, spend it on the 15s, not on the 3s and 4s, right? Let the 3s and 4s come, and they will. And if you can make money out of them, that's okay. I'm not saying don't work them, but let them come through the funnel. But really be working on first step, next step, on those ones that are a little bit higher. Any questions on this? Pretty useful for you. Let's flip. I left you a little blank sheet there. You can use it, copy it. And hopefully that'll be helpful to you when you get back home. Build your own. Part of that opportunity filter, part of that system where the stuff's on the wall, the tip report, is understanding your funnel. I asked you earlier to think about what are the 3 or 4 stages of your sale. You know, for me, I don't know if any of you remember this from your old days, I'm an old ADA guy. Attention, interest, discovery, action. So where are the prospects in that stage, in that funnel? Attention. Have you sent them information? Have you sent them a postcard? Have you sent them an email? Have you left them a voicemail? Attention. Interest. Have they engaged with that stuff? Have they hit your website? Have they responded to your email? Mm-hmm. Did they respond to your phone call? Is there interest? Discovery. To me, discovery is a two-way dialogue. I'm talking. I'm learning. I'm asking questions. They're asking questions. We're going through discovery. We are beginning to share an idea of where they are and how I can help them. That's a real conversation. Dialogue, discovery, and then action. Like I said before, I never leave a meeting without a next step. So what's the action? And action to me is, in a sales funnel context, action to me is a commitment to take time for a demo, to go through a proposal, to go see one of my clients, whatever it is. Action is their commitment of time. And then, you know, present, propose, onboard. I look at this bar on the left, marketing waves, as I talked about yesterday, that you've got some touch in the market every 4 to 6 weeks, just across that funnel. Anybody that's in my funnel is getting something from me. We're going to hear from me somehow. Where do you spend most of your time? I spend most of my time at interest, like watching people and who are poking, and then I'm spending 80% of my time on the action piece. So I'm kind of working the top of the funnel and the bottom of the funnel. That's where I spend my time. So when I feel like I need to get more business, I will work really hard on getting people's attention and hopefully monitoring if I'm getting any interest from that, and then I'm moving people on this action piece down below. I'm talking, like I said yesterday, after you propose work, have some sort of, I call it a toolkit, but have some sort of toolkit that you're making touches after the proposal. Work it. And tell them, no's a good answer. You guys have heard that before.
Yes.
No's a good answer. I don't want to waste your time. Certainly, I'm busy. If you're not going to do this, no's a good answer. You're not going to hurt my feelings. The faster you can get to know, the better. I think it actually releases people a little bit. They feel like, okay, I can trust this person a little bit because they're just not trying to close me. They're not just trying to push me into a close. So I will tell people, this might not be the right time for you. This might not be the right solution for you, but it's something that you should think about. But if you're not going to do it right now, it's okay to tell me we're not going to do it right now. I give them permission to tell me that. Please do. And you'd be surprised how many don't. No, I'm interested. I really do want to talk about it. Good. Then what do you think's next? You know, what's the next step? So that's the action piece. Work the top of the funnel, work the bottom of the funnel. Again, if it helps, you could put, you know, I don't know, again, if there's an office or a room somewhere where you work, if you could put this stuff up on your wall with a tip report, you got stages 1, 2, 3, 4, and you could kind of even put on your tip report the stage that they're in. You know, or where they're at, using your opportunity filter. Again, this might seem crazy to you right now, but I guarantee you if you do this and you pay attention to it, you will start closing more orders. You will pay attention. Those things that we measure, those things that are in front of us, those things that we look at every day are the things that get the most attention in our businesses. Again, if it were an accounting system, you wouldn't wait 3 months to reconcile your credit card account. Most of you would. You wouldn't wait 3 months to pay your bills. You look at it, you know, I look at my money every day, every week, all the time. I know what's going on. I look at the invoice report. I look at the accounts receivable report. I look at the bank statement. I look at online every day. Sales the same way. No reason in the world why we can't find time to grow our business. It's only because we've not prioritized it. We think we're too busy. And too busy, to me, just means we need to reprioritize our days a little bit. Flip the page.
I think this goes back to what you said. And I made a phone call to my office yesterday afternoon. And reevaluate.
I made a phone call to his office. Yeah.
Well, reevaluate everybody's position in the business so we prioritize what we do best.
Yeah.
And I was mentioning that to my wife and to one of my sons. And it's one of the meetings we're going to have next week.
Yeah. What does each person do best, and make sure that we're making the time for them to be brilliant at that and get it done.
Yeah.
This may not be my area of expertise, but the son is yours. And I'd like you to have 4 hours a week or 8 hours a week to do this, or more, whatever it might be.
So that we don't waste any time.
Right. Yeah, that's an interesting point too. If you do have an organization with people in it, if you have 6, 8, 10 people, you know, there's certain people that are 8s, 9s, and 10s at certain things. And, you know, we're all 8, 9, and 10 and something, and we're also 2, 3, and 4 and some other things, right? So let's make sure that on this particular work that the best you can, if you have a staff of people and you've got some 8, 9s, and 10s out there that know how to do this stuff, cut some time out for them to do it. It'll be brilliant. You'll get a bigger result. So let's talk a little bit about tip report. Top interested prospects. This is what it would look like. This is what COACs looks like. This is what we build for our clients. Again, on that wall, I've mentioned it a few times. It could be on a whiteboard. It can be, I've seen people do it just on an Excel spreadsheet, post it. You could do it on an easel pad and just keep tearing the sheets off. But I think on a regular basis, everybody should walk by it and see it and know what we have. So what's the account name? If it's important to you, where are they? What you call the opportunity name, if you have a name for it. The contact, I like the contact information on there myself, because we do this online. So I like it because I can make a phone call. So I want to know the guy's name and phone number, and I'll tell my person, I'm going to follow up with this guy. And I'll call him up and say, hey, you've been talking with Melanie, wanted to see where you're at, how are things going, is there anything you need from us to make a decision, you know, that sort of thing. And I'll work that tip report. Next step, what the value is, who's the sponsor, that's the owner internally, like who owns this opportunity. Again, if you have multiple people doing it, make sure people know that they're the owner of a certain opportunity. Sometimes I see that too. There's an opportunity on the tip report, nobody knows who has it. Wow. You know, it doesn't happen often, but it does happen. And then what's the rating? So the tip report helps organize all pre-qualified opportunities in your sales system. Try not to get, I would discourage you from putting, you know, what I say pre-qualified intentionally, because I'd like your tip report to be as high quality as possible, not just a list of a bunch of people you've talked to. These are people that are really in the funnel, pre-qualified. It contains important factual and subjective data about each opportunity. It helps you monitor the health and effectiveness of your sales system. Every week, I have an Excel spreadsheet, and I punch in the number of opportunities, the value of opportunities, how many proposals we've done, how many closes we've done every week. I punch into a spreadsheet and I get a graph. And the cool thing about that is I can look back to 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, and I start to see trends, and I can say, you know what, we're having an impact. This time last year I had 8 open proposals. Right now I have 12. Last year, those 8 proposals were worth $57,000. Now I have open proposal value of $98,000. I don't know about you, that gets me going. And when I'm not at the numbers I need to be at, let's go. You know, I'm working with my team. We're talking about, okay, who do you got? I don't have anybody right now. Okay, by tomorrow, I want you to have 2. You find them. I don't care how you find them. Get 2. You get 2. Let's go. Because we're not... We're at 50% of where we were last year this time. There's only a few reasons that's going to happen. I don't buy the economy's down. I don't buy that stuff. The market's too damn big for the economy to be down for you guys. If you had 80% market share, then I believe that stuff. But you don't. You got like 1/10 of 1/10 of 1% market share. So the economy's down. All right. So instead of $1 billion market, I only have an $800 million market. So yeah, I understand it slows down, but when things slow down, you need to speed up. So again, if it's me, I'm building a simple Excel spreadsheet, and every week I'm tracking 3 or 4 numbers, and next year at this time, I'm gonna know what I was doing. I wanna know if the quality of my opportunities is getting better, but more than anything, I wanna know how many opportunities, the value of those opportunities, and you know, for you, you might track the amount of time that it takes for somebody to close from proposal on, you get a feel for that. You'll get really, really good at forecasting. And my goal is always, you know, I always tell people better is good. Better is good. You know, I don't really set goals. I'm not a real big goal guy, and I know that's crazy for a salesperson. I just want to get better. Every week, every month, every year, I want to get better. But you really can't, in my view, even Deming would tell us this, and everything you read on what I would consider to be a high-performing system. The only way you can even begin to think about goals is understanding what the system can produce. What is this process capable of producing? And if you don't track this stuff, I don't know how you set a goal. It's real easy to say I'm gonna have $1 million in sales this year, but you really have no idea how many proposals does it take to get there, what proposal dollars does it take to get there, what's your close rate, both in number of proposals and percentage of value. I want to know that stuff. Because it's almost like the old sales story, you heard this maybe, where the door-to-door sales guy, he's selling vacuum cleaners. He makes $100 every time he sells a vacuum cleaner. It takes him 10 calls, 10 knocks. Out of 10 knocks, he gets one vacuum cleaner. So the story goes that, you know, the first door he knocks and the person says, no, I'm not interested. And he walks away and he says, thank you for the $10. He goes to the second door, no, I'm not interested, thank you for the $10. Gets to the 10th door, gets the order, sells it, walks away, says, thank you for the $10. You know what I'm saying? So it's really important to kind of have that mentality when it comes to sales. Everything you do has a dollar value on it. Everything you do, don't look at, I made a $50,000 sale. It took 50 calls to do that, $1,000 a call. Pretend you get paid $1,000 for every call you make. How many would you make? A bunch. A bunch. So be thinking about those kind of things. That really is the mentality around sales. Thank you for the $10. You just never know where it's going to come. I've gotten orders from the craziest places. Any questions on the tip report? Again, I hope you're starting to see this wall or this report in your office. Build the Excel spreadsheet. We can keep track of stuff so that you know what's going on. Yes?
What tool do you use in your office to do this? You said you have a special tool.
We do our tip reports in Excel.
Okay.
And then there are fields that are attached to other fields that give us our KPI, you know, our key
performance. Yeah, a master one that everybody looks at.
Yep. Okay. Yep. We have a master file. I was looking at it this morning. We have a master KPI Excel spreadsheet. It's probably worth a minute here. And it's got 4 tabs on it. The first tab is prospects, proposals. And it's a list of every proposal COACT has ever issued. And it's got organization's name, contact name, the date of the proposal, the value of the proposal, and then it's got a note, and it's got next step action date. That's one tab. The next tab is clients. And I keep track of every client, every close. when it closed, how much it was worth, who it was, all that. Next is people, because if I grow my business, I need more people, so I look at things like utilization, coverage, all that sort of thing. And I keep track of, you know, revenue per person, those sort of things on that sheet. And then those things are all connected to a summary sheet that's the last tab under. And that summary sheet, again, it sounds like a lot. It took me a half a day on a Saturday. I'm pretty good at Excel. If you're not, find somebody in your business that is, or a friend, or your CPA, or somebody. It's not that hard. Take 2 hours, put together a spreadsheet. I built the graphs in one day, and now the graphs just go forever. You know, I just unhide a column, unhide a column, unhide a column every week, and I get these graphs. It's fun. And you post that stuff up, and you talk about it every week, every day, every month, whatever. I think once a month is not enough. If you're not talking about business growth with your team, with yourself, looking at least weekly, you're really not paying that much attention to it. Again, there's other systems servicing your clients, installations, collecting money. You would never think of going a month before you look at that stuff. Again, that's that supply side, right? We're all focused on the supply side because that builds a lot of muscles. The supply side, customer says, hey, good job. They send you money, that's great. That supply side builds a lot of muscles. The demand side's hard. That's why you gotta kind of trick yourself. Thank you for the $10. But build these systems and it'll get a little bit easier. Again, easel pad, whiteboard, Excel spreadsheet, whatever it is, whatever works for you. When I first started it, though, I have to say, years ago, I did it on a whiteboard. When COAC was one person and one client, it was all we did on a whiteboard. It was pretty easy, because we only had like one proposal every 6 weeks. You know, now we're doing two a day, you know, one a day. So, flip the page, let's go to knowledge management. This is a tough topic for some of us, maybe, but what I would like to talk about in knowledge management is how you gather, organize, and report market and prospect information. So we've been talking about this a little bit. When we talk about key performance indicators in that war room wall, you're kind of doing knowledge management. You're gathering information, you're organizing it, and then you're reporting it or leveraging it for use in your organization. This should better inform the organization's strategic decision making. That's where you want to go. If you have salespeople, you want to understand why salesperson A gets different results than salesperson B. They're both working the same market, they both have the same kind of prospect list. Why does A outperform B? And can I prove it? He closes faster, closes more, wherever it might be. Knowledge management is gathering, organizing, I'll say analyze and report information. It should help you make better decisions around your business. Again, these things are, you do this every day, you do this every week in other parts of your business. You look at your receivables. When you're thinking about spending money or buying a new truck or whatever it might be, you're looking at things in your system to make better decisions. You're looking at data. Sales is the same way. How many of you have a CRM package, customer relationship management system? About a third, maybe, a fourth. I highly recommend it. For those of you who haven't crossed the bridge yet into that, customer relationship management is a system where you can organize prospects and clients. So it's they're customized systems that are designed purely for the use of putting in names, titles, phone numbers, email addresses, conversation records, notes with date stamps. You can get packages that cost $49. Up to Salesforce.com, which we use, it cost us, last year I spent $26,000 on CRM. So,
we have one for the company. The company has one.
Good. Oh, CoCard has one.
Pegasus.
Yeah.
Good for you guys.
I think for members here that don't have their own, we give them a solution.
Good.
Contact management.
They just got to use it.
It's good. Well, I'll tell you what, if you really want to speed up your sales success, look at the CRM. Load those prospects in there, get those names loaded, get their emails in there, their phone numbers, conversation record. When you have an opportunity, the system probably tracks a proposal or opportunity for you. It probably gives, the CRM may output some of these reports I'm talking about.
Even Sales Gene, I was a one person shop working out of my house. If I'm using Sales Gene to get my leads, they have for free a contact management system. So
yep.
Everyone has that access to use now.
Yep. Yep. There's Sales Gene, there's Apt. Apt is, you know, you can buy a box, you can load Apt up, I think it's like $129. And it's beautiful. I used Apt for years and years and years as a salesperson. The cool thing about it is, I know it takes a minute. Every time you load a prospect, it takes a minute. But when you decide, hey, I want to send out a postcard, or I want to send an email, or whatever it is, it's dink, there's your list, boom, go. It's not a 3-day activity. If you've got a good CRM and you keep it organized, it gets really easy to touch the market. So customer relationship management, CRM, sounds like CoCard has some of this stuff. Look into it. Some people use Excel spreadsheets. You know, I get it, but I think it's just, that makes it really hard. It's hard to market off an Excel spreadsheet. It's hard to track date stamp conversation records in an Excel spreadsheet. Yes?
Well, this is going to sound like the doubting Thomas.
I love it.
Leave myself up to some abuse here. But we went away from the employee model, you know, the salary model, because we couldn't get our people to participate in the CRMs that we had to use. I mean, and then when it comes to 1099, I mean, when it comes to agents and stuff, they're all very guarded with their information.
Yep.
And, you know, so it's hard to make projections, and we're constantly fighting with getting the information. Every week I send a request to Melissa on Monday morning, you know, how many deals did we get last week? What are we going to get this coming week? You know, did you talk to, I talked to them all. They didn't put anything in. I mean, they don't feel like they're obligated. So, I mean, a lot of the entrepreneurial types, they guard their information, and they really don't like the paperwork part. They like the activity and the action part. You know, and it's really, really hard. I mean, so that's where some answers that way. But
we got tired
of paying salaries because we couldn't get the people we were paying salaries, you know, to report what they were doing.
A lot of experienced salespeople have objectives. I know objectives are the Salesforce.com or other systems.
Right.
Because they feel they can sell. And if they're producing, they don't want to be tied down to meetings and responsibilities and the answer to what they're doing and spend an inordinate amount of time going over with others that are just taking their time away from going and doing what they do best is selling. They feel if the results are that they're producing, leave me alone, get out of my way, let me go do what I do best.
Yep.
That's an objection that I see.
And there's one more factor that is real important into this whole planning and management thing.
Yeah.
It depends what generation you're from and what tools you're used to using.
Yeah.
For instance, you said I use Excel spreadsheets, and I said, damn right we use Excel spreadsheets. She uses Google Analytics. She uses the Pegasus CRM. She uses all the high tech stuff. And, you know, I'm short circuit on that. I want to see Excel spreadsheets, you know? I don't want to have to load in passwords. What's my password? What level do I have? What do I have to do to get there? Give me the goddamn report. It's a big problem in organizations because you've got two or three generations of people used to using different forms to get their information?
Well, it's a little bit outside of the scope of this conversation, but I think a lot of what you're talking about has more to do with organizational dynamics and organizational behavior, culture. I would even say value system. I've had sales teams, I've managed a lot of salespeople, and you get these pushback, and I've had 1099s, and I've had salaried people. I think you have to clarify the expectation. I think, and I know it's tough for some, but I had salespeople, some really professional salespeople, come to me and say, so what do you want me to do, Mark? You want me to sell, or you want me to put stuff in the CRM?
Yeah, that's...
And I said, yes. And if it's not in the CRM, by the way, I'm not going to pay you for the close. How about that?
Uh-huh.
Well, that, we're living in, I don't know about everybody else here, we're living in a group of people where everybody that we deal with, every salesperson, is an independent contractor.
Yeah.
And they're all looking at us going, shoot, every time I've had good salespeople,
yeah,
they've gone off and started their own sales organization.
Right.
Too many conferences.
I think this is good for everybody.
It's good for
you. You and I have a lot in common. So I actually have employee salespeople. I don't have independent contractors, but I have both. What I do, especially the millennials that come in and work for me, I'll take my inside sales team. They come in when I hire them. I said, here's the deal. This is called a tracking sheet, and it's a piece of paper on the copier, and it's number of dials, number of contacts, number of presentations, number of sets, number of not interested, and they, with a pencil, and they do this. They're going, what kind of organization I come work for? Okay, what are you talking about? I said, listen, this is your formula for success. If you do this, this isn't for me to see how many dials you make every day. Okay, yeah, they have to buy into it. They really don't. Until all of a sudden I say, just trust me on this, let's work it. This is for your benefit, it's not for me, okay? And once I get them on that track, in order for this to succeed, they have to buy into it.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden they buy into it. You come to my office today, you'll see my inside reps, every day they track every dials. I can wake them up at 2 o'clock in the morning, they'll know their closing percentage. On 100 dials, I talk to 10 owners, I close to 2 sales. They bought into it. That's where you get it in. As far as the contact management system they use, they know it's key to their success. It's not for me. It's not for me. So that's where you talk about is the culture, the organization, how you present it. You can't say if you don't do it, you're not going to get paid, but I prefer them understanding this. This is how you're going to be successful.
Set the expectation.
Yeah.
That this is just the way things get done here. It's hard when you're making change. You know, some of these people have been with you for 10 years. And I would agree with you on commission sales. We do a lot of work with commission salespeople, and they see that as their book of business, not yours.
Right.
You know, and that's a struggle. That's a struggle. But again, there's things that you can do to kind of help. Right now, you're incentivizing them to close business. So they get paid some commission on close. It might be risky for you, but you can change that formula. You can make it less for close, more for proposal, or you can pay certain values for different things. You can give them $5 for every new entry in the CRM, or 10, or whatever it is. I think these industries, sometimes we're having like 100% commission salespeople. It's a little bit harder, there's no doubt about it. But your risk is also zero in that scenario. So if you want to increase your risk a little bit, then you pay a little bit and you get things done. But I don't know, I've managed both kind of sales teams. We get it done. I agree with Dan a little bit. I think you need to, and as far as the two different systems and all that, she needs to help you see the light, you know. You know, I think it's really, I don't think it's a good practice to have two. I don't think each salesperson has their own system tracking this stuff. I think that'll kill you. So I know that's hard, because you're right, different generations, we all have different, experiences with different pieces of software and things that we do. You know, somebody in your organization can teach you the best systems and collaborate on it, build a shared idea of what you want to do and do it. And then you can learn it. Even, you know, I'm the same way. I mean, I'm standing up here. I personally don't use Salesforce.com. But I'm fortunate enough, I have an assistant who does it for me. So I tell her, I put my conversation records in an email, and they load them into Salesforce.com for me. So that my team, on everything that I do, they see. So that's what I do. Because I'm kind of like you a little bit in this area, but somebody's got to do it. Somebody's got to get it into the company system. And I think it is the company system. Any other comments on that? I think that's a good comment. I like it. I think there's some nuances to this that you need to think about. And when you have these like high commission salespeople, there's other ways to get this information and track it. But I think the equity that you're building in your organization has a lot, you know, they're benefiting from your brand also. So we got a handshake here a little bit. Yeah.
I think also coming on what you just said, because I've got a guy up in Colorado who's all, you know, I'm down in Florida, who's going and approaching hotels, and when he informs us and puts information in the system, lets us know, those hotels call us sometimes, and we actually close the sale for him. And he has nothing to do, but it's still his deal.
Right.
And it just makes we work together, and that helps out. You know, it's not like we're working against each other. We're working together. So
yeah, I love the idea.
Can you ask folks to speak a little louder?
Yeah, he was just saying that he has a salesperson that's in a location in another state, and he may introduce the opportunity, but they kind of team close it. You know, they may close it here for an account out of state, someplace else. They work together. It's very much a collaborative system, and that's a way too. I mean, you can help. You can do those sort of things. Team selling is very effective, useful, fun.
One thing we do is when they list it, it becomes a protected account. It becomes their account.
So that's a good strategy. I've seen that work.
Yeah, that's good.
I've seen that work.
You know, if I was to hire agents, we have Pegasus. You give them the tool. I've got this great tool for you to use to be successful. Sell them on the idea that they have to have the funnel, they have to create this. I'm going to give them the tool, Pegasus, which we have access to monitor. And everything. So if you provide them the tool and they buy into that tool, well then, it's pretty much taken care of.
Right. That's good. Flip the page real quick. Let's talk a little bit about these KPIs, the key performance indicators. Again, I like to think of these indicators, you know, build scorecards, as I said earlier, scorecards of activity, progress and results. Keep your KPI data current. Review it regularly, build transparency. I always say that the faster my people know something that they didn't know before, the better, faster, higher quality decisions they can make. So I share a lot of data. I know some of you might not be comfortable doing that, and I understand it. Every culture is a little bit different. But I share a lot of data with my people. They know when our sales are up. They know when our sales are down. They know when proposals are up, when they're down. They know when we're short-staffed, when we're overstaffed. And I don't need to talk about it that much, because it's all up on the wall. They know when we're a person and a half big. Everybody looks around. We're a person and a half big. We need to sell some stuff. And so everybody knows it every week. And they know when we're a person and a half small. And I get requests to hire somebody. And I said, well, of course, we're down. You need a person to get in here. So it's just the faster I can get them information, the better decisions they can make, faster decisions they can make. And I'll say for yourself, the more transparent you are in the organization, just for you to understand what's going on in the organization, the better decisions you make, faster you make. So I put some examples down here of things that you can track. Like at COACT, again, we're an outsource of inside sales and marketing. So we track, I got four different sections, but the one that I think you're most interested in, I track number of calls, that's dials, every day. Every single day on a board, we put how many calls were made, how many completed calls. Completed call is with a decision maker, not a gatekeeper. That's not somebody who answers the phone. Thank you for calling XYZ company. That's not a completed call. A completed call is speaking with a decision maker, a buying influence. I keep track of correspondence. How much correspondence was sent? How many emails were sent? How many letters were sent? and how many thank you notes were sent. Every day, we track those in our CRM. I got graphs on the wall every day we look at it. And then we have something called a highlight, which is a notable conversation, somebody we had a conversation with, that I always look at a pre-qualified opportunity needs three things. It needs to have genuine interest or need. There needs to be money, budget, or funding for the project. And three, there needs to be a time frame in mind when they're going to make a decision. I don't care if they tell me it's 6 months from now or a year from now, that's good. We're going to look at this in September, that's good. We're going to look at this in February, that's good. So genuine interest or need, money, budget, or funded project, and then three, a time frame. If they don't have all three of those things, but it's a really good conversation and we're working towards it, we call that a highlight, a notable conversation. Somebody might have a need, they just don't have the money. They want to do this next October, but they don't have the money right now. So I track highlights, and then I track meetings, and then I told you all the other stuff I track. Proposals, value proposals, closes, when they close, the value closes. So you pick your, that's why they call them key performance indicators. You pick your key indicators in your business and keep track of them on a regular basis. Again, for us, phone calls, completed calls, correspondence, highlights, meetings. It's tougher in some systems than others, but if you can do it, do it. You'll be able to track the correlation. Because like right now, somebody, a client will ask me, he'll say, you know, or a prospect will ask me about COAC. They'll say, well, what's the ROI on COAC? And I'll say, well, I don't close orders. You know, I don't price product, I don't specify solutions, and I don't close orders. So COAC's ROI is zero. Oh, well, Mark, that's not going to work. We need to close some business. Well, let's talk about what I do know. We're going to make this many phone calls. We're going to make that many completed calls. We're going to set up this many meetings. I can tell you about the percentage of meetings we'll set up based on phone calls. So then I say to them, out of 10 meetings, how many of those meetings will result in a proposal for you with a pre-qualified prospect? You should know this. When you have a meeting, a discovery meeting, how many of those meetings lead to a proposal? You should know it. Just like that. And out of those proposals that you issue, what percentage of those proposals will you close? And what percentage of value of the proposals will you close? Both are really important. You can close 80% of the number of proposals that you submit and only could close 20% of the dollars that you propose. You know what I mean? You're missing the big ones. You're missing maybe the ones you want, I don't know. So, key performance indicators. You decide what are the three or four things in your business that are important to track and keep track of. And again, I think it's important to let everybody know as much as possible, because I think people make better decisions. Questions on that? We talked a lot about KPIs, directly and indirectly. Next page, talked about it yesterday, making waves. If you have your CRM package, it gets a little bit easier, but a series of touch points that removes the variable of timing and installs waves of communication and learning. Waves of communication and learning. And if you wanted, you could say teaching and learning. You know, learning about their systems and teaching them how your solution makes sense in their business. Communicating to them. Build this around your value propositions. Again, I think when you build these waves, what you're doing is you're making those touch points, those interactions, and you keep bringing those value propositions to the right to the front. We have this many trucks, we're local, the money stays here, our people and families live and work here. We have 116 customers in this region. We are, you know, you whatever those value propositions are that you think make a dramatic difference in your clients' businesses, keep talking about it, keep talking about it. Must-haves, right? The two, three, four things that you just keep, you keep hitting them with it. Create a rhythm in the market that serves as a framework for your demand process. create a rhythm. You know, they used to say about advertising, you know, people would call you and they would say, hey, you want to advertise in the newspaper or whatever it might be. And you may remember this, that, you know, it doesn't make any sense to advertise unless you put it in the newspaper every week for 10 or 12 weeks. You can't just put an ad in the newspaper and expect that people are just going to start calling you. Create a rhythm that becomes predictable. You know, the big companies that spend billions of dollars on advertising, Anheuser-Busch, Coca-Cola, McDonald's, these people, they got it down. They know how often to run a commercial, where to run a commercial, all of those things. They just don't run one commercial. They run them at different times, at certain intervals, in a rhythm, and they spend billions of dollars to get you to think about their brand. Of course, in B2B, we can't do that. So we have to use postcards, emails, phone calls. Have a rhythm. Make it predictable. Don't do a newsletter for 3 months and then not do one for six.
Your methods are outdated here. You're talking email. You're talking Skype.
Yeah.
You're talking text message. Yeah. You're talking cell phone calls, office calls. Everybody has patterns in the way that they communicate and that you can reach them. For instance, I'll give you an example. We're dealing with an offshore company that we get started with.
Yeah.
And we've spent 3 days pulling out our hair trying to get in touch with our customer service person to board an app. And all of a sudden, lo and behold, we found out she answers Skype.
Skype,
she
yeah.
does not answer her cell phone. She does not answer her telephone. She does not always reply to emails. But everybody has a method they're comfortable with and that they do. And part of this process is to get the touches.
Yeah.
Effective touches, you got to figure out which way they communicate.
No, I would agree with that.
Yeah,
I would agree with that. But that's usually deeper in the funnel. You don't understand that stuff until you have them deeper in the funnel.
Okay.
You know, I know what you're saying, and I don't disagree with you. We have people that just do Skype. We have people that just do text. And, but it's still not a majority of the market.
And once again, that's a generational thing too,
yeah.
Because I'd like to get a mail. Nice, beautiful picture, postcard, thanks for your business. Oh, that was nice of them doing that. But, you know,
a
millennial, they say, what the hell is this? Pew!
Some. Well, you'll notice I don't say fax. You know, that's nobody uses fax anymore. There'll be a day when maybe email does go away. It's still pretty prevalent today. And most people do look at direct mail, even the millennials, you know, they'll look at it, even if it's only for 3 seconds on the way to the trash can, they see the logo, and that's what we're really trying to get them to think about.
And what I'm saying is, you know, you can't give up because you send a text and they don't reply. Well, try calling their cell phone instead of texting.
Right.
You know, and, you know, you just got to find out the method that they're doing.
Cause yeah. I have a customer who's a dear friend. He's probably, I'm guessing Ryan's probably about 45 years old. He has never responded to an email. Mm-hmm. He will never respond to a text. But if you call him, he picks up the phone every single time.
Right.
And that's kind of the opposite of me. You know, the phone's hard for me. I don't have 15 minutes a lot of times, but I can do a 60-second email. So he and I somewhat have kind of a little bit of a disconnect in the way we communicate, because he likes to call, and I always say, drop me an email. He never drops me an email. He calls me, and then I don't answer.
Yeah, it's kind of like the matching strategy in sales. You know, the guy's standing there like this, and you're selling them, so you stand there the same way, and you're matching. So you're matching the forms of communication that can effectively help you reach your goal.
Well, I totally agree with that.
Yeah.
You know, I just think you need to find it. Once you find it, then, you know, these waves get different from that person. They get different from that person. Any questions on this? Create that rhythm. The next page, I gave you a little blank sheet if you wanted to start filling that in. It is useful, again, if you know where you're at. We call them wave plans, in your wave plan. This month we're going to send something on this product. Next month we're going to send something on this product. The next, and everyone again should push some value prop. You're trying to stay top of mind. You're trying to make people aware of who you are, what you do, why it's important. And you're trying to eliminate the variable of timing. The last thing you want is somebody that you've spoken to a year ago buy something not from you. It's tough. It's tough, and it happens all the time. And it's just because you didn't stay in touch. Mm-hmm. And staying in touch is, like I said, it's an email, it's a Skype, it's a postcard, wherever it might be. So create your wave plans on an interval, a rhythm that you can manage, and stay on it. So take a few minutes on this last sheet before we close out. And, you know, I want you to write this stuff down because I want you to take it home and look at it and think about it. So what was the most interesting or useful thing that you learned during this workshop? What will you do next week to develop new behaviors? Now, I've been to these kind of things. Believe me, I've been you in the audience listening. I've put a lot of stuff out there for you to think about. What's the one, two, or three things you can, will, must do? I'd love to see you build this whole thing, and I'd love to have you call me in 6 months and say we did it, and I'd be excited. But what is the one thing you're going to do in the next week that's going to develop new behaviors? What is your personal three-month goal? Try to be specific, even if it's one thing. And then lastly, before we leave today, what questions do you have? Take a few minutes. Is that you guys can manage and build.
And then also I think the targeting of an industry and learning as much as you can about your target is critical. So I don't think selling merchant services and point of sale to anyone who needs it, because there's lots of businesses that do, is really a great way to target. Yeah. And it just makes you just like everyone else.
Right.
So I think it's important to either have your reps or your offices really decide how they want to specialize, and then build tools and networks and information around that to create reasons to have conversations with people.
Yep. So specializing in a market, getting really good at it, telling your story around it, and being the best or competing with the best in it.
Right. And then lastly, and I think this is really is focusing on the things that are actually making you money.
Right. Focusing on those things that are actually making you money. Good. Thank you. Anyone else on that first question?
I think we need to continue to get the attention from prospect, at least 7 or 8 or 9 times. Mm-hmm. Don't give up to even though no response, but still we have to continue to pay attention.
Thank you for mentioning that. I think it's really important. Many of us, some of you will go home, you will try some of this for 3 or 4 months, and you'll say, that didn't work. And it won't work in 3 or 4 months. But it will in 9, 10, 11, 12 months. Stay on it. Stay persistent.
Mark, it's interesting you said trying to get better, and I think about, I'm kind of
involved with Maryland basketball, University of Maryland basketball. And the great coaches, all they ever do is say, early in the year, all we're trying to do is get better.
Get better.
Not like anything specific, but better.
Get better.
So better. That was interesting.
I wrote that down. I put in my office, big. Better is good.
Yeah.
I like that more than goal setting. So I got that. I wrote that down. Big.
Any other comments?
Something important that you mentioned, I don't know if you mentioned today, but you mentioned yesterday, remember to focus on growth, because you get so busy in this industry, you forget about expanding your business, about growing. That's
important. Yeah, we get busy doing, we all do it, every business does it, not just your industry. You're not the only industry that's busy. Everybody's really busy, but you gotta spend time working on your company. You gotta spend time, the best companies work on themselves and get them done. On the last question, are there any burning questions that you have right now that we didn't get answered? Raise your hand if you have one. You've had some good questions already.
For me, it's implementing the waves. We talked about a toolkit last night on the boat, mm-hmm. and you do it in your company, those toolkits. Mm-hmm. What is that?
There are a number of things that you can do. A toolkit for us is taking our value propositions and things, like for us, it's showing clients results of our work, like even meeting profiles. So when we do a 3-to-5-page report, when we set up a meeting for a client, that's one tool. So we'll send that out to a prospect and say, when we set up meetings for you, this is what they look like. This is an example of a meeting profile. This is who you're going to meet with. These are the three people. This is the decision maker. This is the person who supports your solution. Here's the conversation records. This is who they're using today. This is how much they buy. So we send a meeting profile. That's part of our toolkit. And we say, here, this is a sample of that. We send them samples of our work. We send them customer advocacy things. So the toolkit for us, the business growth toolkit, has got 4 or 5 things in it. And we'll issue a proposal. And for whatever reason, it stalls. They don't make the decision. I tell my team, start the toolkit. Boom. Every week for 4 to 6 weeks, that customer who I sent a proposal to, who's not closing, starts getting stuff from us. And it works. It works.
So when you said set up a toolkit for CoCard, it might be 6 different thank you letters or
examples of your work. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Advocacy, you know, maybe it's a letter from a customer. 98% satisfaction, or what, you know, whatever that toolkit is that you think is going to move somebody to buy. Those are the things. So for us, it's examples of our work and those kind of pieces that we send out. Most people don't buy CoCard because they still don't understand enough. They don't trust enough. So we start sending them stuff that shows the depth and quality, completeness of our reporting and work. Yes?
I send out to my merchants, if I haven't closed someone, I'll pull a statement, one of my customer statements, black out their name, black out their address, put the overall rate on it, and I'll send it to them. And yeah. This could be you, this could be you, this could be you. And after 3 or 4 of them, they call me and say, hey, is it real? And I'm
okay, so should we take a quick 10?
I think.
Okay, quick 10, and we're going to...